thesis. Might be a little different angle here. I will close because the second presentation is by Christina on EPAs, which is an important topic, but which is different from Mr. Kotte's topic. So I would propose to split this session into two. At first, Mr. Kotte's presentation and discuss that, and then introduce this presentation. Well, how much time do you need for time? Okay, how much time did you want?
Well,
we set, you said
30 minutes, but it could be a little bit longer.
Okay, so 30 minutes, but it can be a little bit longer.
Okay,
40 minutes, maybe I'll stop. Okay, then the floor is yours.
I was asked to make a presentation on some work we did in UNCTAD when I was still a staff member, which I'm no longer, back in 2007, that was 5 years ago, in terms of processes of regional integration with a relatively short time span. I think what we did at the time may be interesting in terms of the issues discussed and the, as Sebastian said, the direction of the arguments made at the, in this report, Trade and Development Report 2007. You may be familiar with the Trade and Development Report. It's the annual analytical report of the UNCTAD Secretariat. It discusses lots of questions in development strategies, international economy, www.unctad.org. You can download all the reports chapter by chapter of, I don't know, since the beginning of the 1990s. I will first briefly look at the relationship, the interdependence of regional integration, development strategies, and the macroeconomic conditions of under which development strategies are carried out and regional integration is aimed at. I will then take up something that Sebastian Berlin has already referred to, the trade, the current trends in international trade agreements outside the WTO or outside the multilateral trade negotiations. Then, since these are mostly, or to a large extent, North-South trade free trade agreements, look at the problematic of these agreements and oppose this to the potential of regional cooperation between developing countries and particularly also try to give some ideas of how regional cooperation would look like if we do not restrain this to trade liberalization as is frequently the case. Finally, I will summarize some of the conclusions. Now, I think the first thing is you may be aware of this, is come with some frustration. Some of you may be greater experts in regional economics than I am, but I think one has to make sure that a clear differentiation between what has come to be called regionalism or even new regionalism, which means policy integration that is based on formal cooperation agreements, and this is quite a different thing from the regionalization process, which is a process of effective integration largely driven by the market, not necessarily exclusively driven by the market, as we may see later on. Policies matter in the speed and the extent of this market integration. New regionalism is, I would say, almost a euphemism for much of the effort of the northern countries, particularly the United States, Europe, but also Japan, to establish bilateral trade agreements with developing countries and thereby bypass multilateral trade rules as they are negotiated, as they are existing and further negotiated in the context of the WTO. Our report in 2007, and that is certainly a truism, found that what matters is much less the formal integration or formal cooperation agreements rather than effective integration. but there's no automatism between increasing formal cooperation and faster integration. One is, it's neither a necessary nor a sufficient condition for effective integration. Liberalization in the context of World Bank and more orthodox development strategies has been often equated development strategies have often been equated in the context of export-led growth strategies with trade liberalization, and that would, in principle, that means in principle a reduction of state involvement in the shaping of international economic relations, but also in shaping the development process through active trade and through active industrial policies. However, the experience shows that effective regional cooperation, including in Europe, requires active policies and strong governments, strong states. In this sense, the regionalism approach, if we are looking at the South, and the regionalization processes are interdependent and can be important elements of successful development strategies. And they have been important elements in successful strategies in Europe as well as in East and Southeast Asia, and increasingly so in Latin America, and also in some parts of Africa, but much less generalized. The attempt by some industrialized countries, the willingness of a number of developing countries to engage in North-South trade agreements and also investment agreements are part of the idea that export-led growth is the best way, the most effective way in a globalized economy to advance development. On the other hand, it increases dependence on these relations between developing countries and the northern countries. Regional integration among developing countries, on the other hand, is an instrument by which what we perceive as a domestic market could increase. There's one pair of excess pair of inverted commas and the market should be there. So the domestic inverted commas, it makes the domestic market a regional market rather than a purely national market. And it can also, like we have seen in Europe, like we have seen in East and Southeast Asia, also involve the tightening and enlargement of the regional production networks. Such integration reduces dependence on the North, and I think this is an important difference also for policy decisions to be taken in the context of regional integration policy. My second, why is this opposed to each other, North-South versus South-South integration? The fact is that the trade agreements notified to the WTO since the 1990s, this table has been updated compared to the 2007 report to 2012, shows a clear-cut tendency that the agreements notified to the WTO basically consist of bilateral agreements, the blue part of the column, and that particularly this kind of agreements has rapidly increased since the 1990s. The plurilateral agreements have also grown, but much less so. This illustrates the tendency of a number of countries to advance the liberalization process compared to what is achieved in the multilateral trade negotiation. Most of these agreements have been at a relatively, say, low level of commitment, in the sense that they basically consist of free trade agreements rather than preferential trade agreements and customs unions, rather than customs unions in particular, which are of course going further than free trade agreements. And that is the most important observation. many of these, in a very large part of these, probably growing faster than any other category of trade unions, have been concluded between developed and developing countries. This second part of the of each column in Pubergy, I don't reach there, but you see what is meant. So most agreements are between countries from different geographical regions. This is why the term new regionalism is odd, because it is not, has very little to do with what one usually considers to be a region, a geographical proximity. But also these agreements have been, that may be more important, between countries at different levels of development. Now, even within developing countries, we have countries with different levels of development, but what is meant here is particularly North-South agreements. What are the problems with these North-South free trade agreements in terms of policy for enhancing catching up processes and industrial structural change and industrialization? Most of the developing countries that engage in such agreements do that because they expect improved access to the market of the much larger market of the industrialized countries, and they are aware, normally they should be aware, of the fact that their domestic policy space for industrial and of course also trade policy is substantially reduced by this, and this is certainly the decision. These are certainly elements that have to be taken into account in the decisions about trade agreements when they are negotiated and concluded. So the motivation for bilateral trade agreements with industrialized countries is improved access to developed countries' market of the individual country, but it's also a means to compete out other countries at a similar level of development, and often in the same region, often neighboring country. So one tries to achieve to obtain concessions from the industrialized country, and others do not receive. And this, from a different perspective, this competition about access, about market for market access, is also to conclude such agreements because there is a risk that one loses competitiveness vis-à-vis those countries that have already concluded trade and investment agreements with the same trade the North. So there is a kind of domino effect that may explain why many governments in developing countries are favorable to bilateral agreements, although in international bodies like the UN, for example, they often complain about the problematic of losing policy space in the WTO, in other international agreements, but at the same time, concluding bilateral agreements would often are much more constraining their national policies and the multilateral agreements. Now, that may be the motivation, but the motivation is often not leading to this, to the, followed by the results for various reasons, because developing countries, this is of course now a very general remark, developing countries, there are so many different countries, but often their supply capacity, that is certainly true in many cases in Africa, the supply capacity of these economies is much more limited than what their developed country partners can supply. So the potential to adjust to whatever new trade opportunities may arise on paper is much more limited in the developing country partner than the developed country partner. In addition, the developed countries continue normally manage to have elements in these trade agreements that allow them to continue to subsidize sensitive sectors and to impose quite restrictive rules of origin on the developing country, which often does not have the necessary diversification and the necessary structure to comply with these restrictive rules of origin. So the benefits are mostly much less than what is expected. So therefore, the North-South agreements reduce policy space, but since and much more than multilateral rules, because they have a number of features such as those, some of them are listed here, especially the differential treatment that certain groups of countries can obtain under WTO rules are replaced by full reciprocity of preferences in the bilateral agreement, the liberalization in goods and also in services. It goes much deeper than the agreement with WTO. And also, many of these agreements that have been negotiated in the last 10 years or so go beyond to those areas that are even discussed, not only where the rules exist in WTO, but also the rules that are discussed under WTO, under the context of Doha, and the ground of negotiations, particularly those on labor regulation and the environment. Maybe we have time later on. I don't want to spend too much time on the details here, but I think what is important is to keep in mind, and that is, I don't think anybody will deny this, but it's important to recall that the regional integration between north and south, between northern and southern countries, for sure reduces the policy space for proactive development policies, whereas the benefits from this deal, improved market access against policy space, the benefits from this deal are quite uncertain, to say the least. On the contrary, experience also shows, well, this TDR 2007 tries to show, which is not always easy because it's often difficult to have a counterfactual when you look at the developments. Countries comparing their or opposing their institutional development with economic outcomes, but it appears strongly from this analysis that regional integration among developing countries and among countries in the same geographical region can help to accelerate industrialization and structural change. The reason why countries engage in it, and indeed should engage in this kind of regional trade agreement or cooperation agreements, is that proximity matters. It's a very banal observation, but it is still the case that the trade among all regions, for a large majority of countries, is much further developed and much more intensive between neighbors than between countries abroad. That's not true for all countries, but not true for all goods. Of course, if a country is highly commodity dependent, proximity matters less. But in general, when it comes to trade and manufacturers, this is a very important observation. Even in relatively advanced countries, much of the trade takes place within the same region. So the typical argument, of course, also matters that the market, enlargement of the market may allow the exploitation of economies of scale and economies of scope, which are much smaller at the national level. Therefore, there is a mutual interest between particularly smaller countries of the same region to cooperate and to enlarge their market. And another argument, and another certainly another reason for the conclusion, for pursuing the avenue of regional cooperation within countries of the same region, is that there may be greater convergence of interest in dealing with global economic matters and developing strategies for development, and also developing macroeconomic strategies and macroeconomic policy, because countries with close trade relations with relatively advanced degree of integration also have a greater interest in coordinating these policies, whereas at the same time, coordination of these policies helps to advance them. Now, in developing countries, the observation that intra-regional trade is of importance, of course, this is an observation that applies to a different extent to different groups of countries. In East and Southeast Asia, these things. I apologize. I tried to get figures from my colleagues, but it was not possible to update this until 2010. So anyway, if anything, this share of intra-regional trade, and maybe some of you knew better and know better about it, in most of these regions, has certainly continued to follow this rising trend. As I said, in the first half of the 2010 period, it was in the order of 42% from Asia. It was less in Latin America, with the exclusion of Mexico, and it was smallest among the largely oil-dependent states of West Asia. If you take the average, in Africa, the intra-regional trade has stagnated since the late 1990s at a relatively low level. Again, this is, as we will see, related to structure, but also to some other basic preconditions that are not fulfilled. This is maybe the time is not sufficient to look in detail at each of these charts. These are the charts plotting the development, the evolution of intra-regional trade over almost 50 years from the beginning of the 1960s in different regions. We see that in Europe it was already relatively high in about 1965 and has continued to increase. This is the EU-15. The second largest intra-regional trade share is to be found for NAFTA. There are two lines there. One is the average percentage of intra-regional trade for each country in its total trade, and therefore there are big differences if we take or put all the trade of the region together and then calculate it. Therefore, the trends are always the same. The level is slightly different depending on how big is the difference between the size of the economy involved. NAFTA, Mexico, the United States, so there's a huge difference in the size of the economy. And this is why these two measures of average and total intra-regional trade matter is relatively large. But that doesn't matter so much if you compare these different lines. I see that Latin America for a long time in Mercosur, in the Andean community, and in the Caribbean, in the CACM, is it Caribbean common market, has seen large fluctuations, often related to the financial and balance of payments crisis in these countries. However, with a rising trend, at least in the South American ANCOM and Mercosur agreements, after 2000, that is a little bit surprising. The intra-regional trade came down, certainly also due to some commodity price developments, which have raised the value of the extra-regional trade. The level is relatively lower in Africa, that is well known. But even in Africa, for example, COMESA, the Economic Community of the Western African States, ECOWAS, we have seen a long-term trend towards rising intra-regional trade, certainly related also to the upgrading of production, even slow. In this country. I don't need to go into this. This has been mentioned before, the number of regional trade agreements, and since we have many presentations in Africa, I think I can quickly skip that. This is the spaghetti bowl of African trade agreements, which is, say, not really commensurate with the degree of effective integration reached in these countries for reasons of economic structure, but also for reasons infrastructure, particular transport infrastructure, as we may be able to discuss later. Why is this intra-regional trade important? These were just facts showing regional, intra-regional exports are a potential source for industrialization that is maybe more important than trade with the industrialized countries, in the sense that the share of industrial products, that is, high and medium skilled technology intensive manufacturers, very complex, that's a category of goods, and other manufacturers much higher within both geographical region and within the group of countries that has entered an agreement. So it was, let's start with Africa. If we look at these, if we compare the share of exports of manufactured total exports to developed countries, it's much less than the share of exports of African countries, of the Comesa countries, two other Comesa countries, but surprisingly, that is even less than the export share, the share of manufacturing exports to other African countries, which indicates that there's still potential. The same is true for the South African developed community. The same is also true for Mercosur at a higher level, although there within Mercosur, the share of intra-regional trade and manufacturing is higher than that with other Latin American countries, probably due to some effects of the formal cooperation. The same is also true for the Andean community, and the same is true for the ASEAN, it's not a trade agreement, but for the ASEAN cooperation. Now, of course, this is not extremely surprising, particularly if you look at Africa, because much of the exports of Africa are primary products, and there's very little scope for intra-regional trade in primary products, so therefore, much of the total trade isn't primary commodities, goes to the north, so therefore it's not a surprise that if trade takes place between African countries, it is more in the manufacturers they can produce than in the primary products. The same is also true for other countries. On the other hand, it is also interesting to see that if we look at the total production of manufacturers, which as an indication of industrial progress, and look at the destination of exports of these products, we see that most of the, this is technology intensive, science and technology intensive manufacturing. Science and technology intensive manufacturers, which means there is some engineering, some design content compared to other manufacturers which are simpler to produce. In any case, if we take these two together, we also see that in most of these regions, each of these colors in this case represents a region, most of these, actually all regions, the share of manufacturing that goes to developing countries or to countries of the same area is larger than the share of these goods in total exports going to the developed countries. This is an example for Mercosur. I don't have this for all the regions. This is for the Andean community. The picture is quite similar. The two lower parts are larger than the upper parts. So in other words, the intensification of trade or the attempt to intensify trade with developing country neighbors of the same region tends to support those parts of the economy, those sectors that are the more that help to diversify the economy away from the primary sector. I think this is an important observation, and that may be an important important information also for the design and development strategy that takes into account the scope of regional cooperation. This is another chart of the same. Again, it's for Latin America, Caribbean. I don't have these data for Africa, but it's likely to be similar given that the other chart, the share of developed countries and developing countries in the manufacturing is larger in all regions. Now, so why did UNCTAD think in 2007 and still does think so that regional cooperation is helpful, and why did we point to these observations? Because it indicates that regional cooperation can help to accelerate development when it contributes to the structural change. Because if those countries where the share of exports to other countries of the same region has been particularly high, have also been countries in the regions, regional blocs, have also been the countries in regions, regional blocs that have had the fastest growth rates of GDP and per capita GDP over the last 40 years. But the important element is something that, sorry, I have to go back here. The important observation that is made in this report, and I mentioned this right at the beginning, is that the effective regional trade integration cannot be left alone to market forces. In other words, leaving trade cooperation at the level of dismantling tariffs and liberalizing trade is by itself not helpful. It requires, first of all, a macroeconomic dynamic and a high level of investment, as we had in Asia, as we had in post-war Europe, that advances the process of industrialization in the region as a whole, and as a by-effect, we have cross-border investment, and we have cross-border intra-industry trade relations that evolve. Second is that the integration process is often hampered by very down-to-earth problems. That is, for example, connectivity between countries, between neighboring countries. Very often, countries with not landlocked have easier connectivity with countries far away than with their neighboring countries for the simple reason that it is easier to connect. It is not the distance that matters, but it's the transport facility that is available. Therefore, regional cooperation, in order to intensify, to make use, to benefit from this potential that an enlarged market allows, is likely to require other active policies than just trade liberalization. And a number of examples are given. Transit facilities, these are very, from the point of view of economic theory, maybe not particularly sexy, but these are certainly, in many cases, the real obstacles to regional integration. Therefore, trade and transit facilitation by reducing bureaucratic aspects of economic relations, but also information flow between countries. I have a colleague working for the UNCTAD WTO affiliate International Trade Center, and they're organizing trade fairs, for example, at the regional level, and are frequently surprised that, particularly in Africa, producers in neighboring countries do not know from each other, but rather from trading with each other than trade with somebody else in Asia or far away in Oceania. So the information flow will be something very important, a very practical and not policy constraining element of economic cooperation, perhaps. The same is true for the harmonization of industrial standards. All these things were quite important at the very early stage of European integration as well, and may still be important today for many other formal agreements that have not yet yielded the results hoped for. More important than that, even, and more, maybe not more important, or more demanding as a form of cooperation, is the planning and financing of infrastructure, because between two countries that are separated by a mountain chain, liberalize trade as much as you want, there will be no trade, because if it takes too long to make a big detour around this mountain chain, because there's no traffic connection, there's no train connection, there's no road connection that is appropriate to be this country, trade cannot unfold. And the planning and the mutual coordination and the cooperation is often decisive for making trade physically possible, and of course also to reduce the cost of such transport. Another step further, and I think there are some examples, I think in particular in Southern Africa, is the management and the financing of investment projects in crucially important areas that are energy production and water supply. These are often major obstacles for industrial development in countries, and at the same time they have, because not every country is equipped with the same water sources, with the same natural energy sources than others, it includes a regional dimension where countries depend on each other at an early stage and can make this part of their cooperation. And I think, again, this European experience may give, I don't think it is correct to compare all the regional cooperation, regional integration experiences that developing countries may have with the European one, but still the European experience is there and they are made into it. For example, before the European Economic Community was created, there was cooperation between countries in the energy field. The European Community for coal and steel preceded the European Economic Community, and that was one of the first, together with Eurasom, which was called at the time, was then in the 50s, but still believed in the possible wonders that atomic nuclear energy could produce. That's where European economic cooperation started, and I think in a number of countries in Latin America, also in Southern Africa, as I said, there are some projects where they may be more important, when they succeed, than trade liberalization. And the same is true for cooperation in areas that are normally more in the private economy sphere, that is cooperation in industrial development, developing the common industrial policy and financing common industrial projects that are too big for an individual country to be viable, but they become viable as an economic venture if several countries put their resources together and they benefit from these together, is another form of very practical regional cooperation that may be taken into account. And of course, something that has gained considerable prominence in the past, say, 50 years, particularly after the Asian financial crisis, is the cooperation in the field of money and finance, monetary and financial cooperation. We have already heard that we are going to hear more about this from other colleagues. Basically, this need, or the perception that there is a need for such cooperation, monetary and financial matters, results from the perception that there is something wrong with the international financial system, and that the gaps in the international financial system may be closed by regional cooperation. I believe that this is true. The report doesn't take a final position on this, but my personal take is that certainly, as far as the intra-regional monetary and financial relations are concerned, which are very important for the stability of trade and the stability of the basis for decision-making for investment, this is very important. As far as the problematic is between regional or national currency of developing countries and major reserve currencies, I'm afraid that regional monetary cooperation can do relatively little. So there are some well-known advantages and some well-known projects like monetary cooperation in Latin America and also the Chiang Mai initiative in Asia, although the pioneers in monetary cooperation are in Africa due to the, if you like, colonial heritage that has made the CFA zone with a common monetary policy and common currency. There are a number, I think at my time I'm running a little bit, soon out of time, and I should maybe come to the end. There are some instruments far earlier than the common currency as it is attempted, already existing in some African countries, that may be helpful for effective trade integration, and this is the provision of payment facilitation between countries, which involves lower transaction costs. This is something that is pursued quite actively in Latin America. That may go further into reciprocal balance of payments financing between countries without having to go to some multilateral financial institution, and mechanisms for the stabilization of the exchange rate within countries, which are certainly extremely important as one instrument of establishing stable trade relations. In conclusion, well, I've said all this, I repeat it. The upshot of this report, 2007 TPR, there has been some further work in UNCTAD on regional cooperation, particularly with regard to Latin America. And basically, the conclusions are quite similar, that regional cooperation in the formal sense is neither necessary nor a sufficient condition for regional dynamics, which are, however, decisive or can play an important role, not decisive, but can play an important role in advancing economic development. Regional cooperation among developing countries in the same region are definitely preferable to bilateral or regional, so-called regional trade agreements between developing and developed countries from different regions, and even from the same region between Mexico and the North American states, Canada and the US. The effect, the benefits for Mexico appear to have been in terms of development, not in terms of increasing its trade, but in terms of developmental effects, the structural change effects appear to have been quite negative. So important is not so much that they are from different regions, but also that they are developed and developing it from quite different stages of development. Regional cooperation can be important in supporting the industrialization because it has the potential to increase production and exports of these goods. Knowing this may be an important basis for decision making on industrial policies in individual countries, but also industrial policies for all the countries within the regional cooperation. Infrastructure and other areas of trade facilitation may be more important than bringing down trade barriers, or at least are highly important as a complement to whatever trade liberalization, reduction of tariff barriers is. And another conclusion that I've not elaborated on beforehand is that the cooperation among countries may enlarge their policy space as a group. And I think we will have some presentation later on dealing with this question: to what extent has regional cooperation among countries increased their weight at the global level? I think this is an important question that may be a side effect in this context. Now, regional integration, not cooperation, does not result automatically from trade liberalization. And waiting for it to result from trade liberalization alone may be a very long and never-ending process if there is a low macroeconomic and investment dynamic in the geographical region that advances growth and development, and that if there is no cooperation in other areas of liberalization that helps to alleviate certain constraints on development. So the upshot of the report is that regional cooperation among developing countries is not a good thing for political reasons, but it is an important element of development strategies to catch up with the more advanced countries, and it may actually become more important at the present juncture. This is the topic, as far as I know, of the next trade and development report. We have the world economy, which for several years to come will not be able to count as much on growth and global demand from the industrialized countries, from the US and from Europe. So it will be shift the pattern of demand towards developing countries. That's already happening anyway, but this may increase the need for supporting domestic demand, and domestic demand in turn may supplemented by domestic demand within a certain region. So the need to focus less on export-led growth to the world, development-led by exports to the global economy, to the north, may need to be increasingly replaced by development based on domestic demand and based on regional demand. Therefore, I think this is a very topic that we are going to discuss in the next few days. Thank you very much. And I hope, if I didn't bring anything new, maybe if we could have led to remind you of certain crucial elements in the regional cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you, Detlef. Well, I think not everything what you said might be completely understood.
Was meinen wir, welche Arbeit, bisher unbezahlte Arbeit, auch bezahlte Arbeit?
Lateral, this should solve all kind of liquidity problems. But in order to provide stable function of land of last resort, it is highly important to make the distinction between giving liquidity. Liquid entities and insolvent entities. What a central bank should never do is to lend more money to give more liquidity to an insolvent institution. This is quite clear, this is one of the basic rules.